a new spirit, a new soul. And that's with the help of Jesus Christ. I found Jesus in 2006. I became baptized and I got confirmed in the Catholic Church. But any church will do. It's just Christianity. But as time goes on, you can't give up, can never give up faith, because Christ will find you. And you listen to him. He's a whisper in your ear. He always looks for you. And if you listen to him, he will change you. He will turn you into somebody else. The ills of the world are just very superficial. The drugs, the drinking. It doesn't cure anything. It doesn't help anything. You wake up the same time, same place, and you regress each time. But every time you set foot in a church, or you pray, or you read the Bible, something changes you. Something creeps in, and these things you find out that they're irrelevant. They don't mean anything. You gotta have faith in yourself. Faith through God and faith through Jesus Christ, because Christ, he's the new deal. That's what brought me into the Christian faith, is that it's love, it's peace, it's happiness, it's hope. And we can all find that by if we follow the way, if we read the book, if we listen to what Christ has to say to us. He's talking to us all the time. He's giving us blessings. A lot of times in my life I look back in retrospect, and I see all the blessings he's laid on my table. I just didn't listen. I didn't realize what God was doing to me. But God will do it for you if you start listening and you start having faith. I was in prison and in jail for a while, and that's where I found a lot of faith. I found a lot of people talking about faith. If you let yourself go with this, you can shape your life. You'll mold yourself into a totally different person. You'll find happiness. Because happiness is not here. This is the devil's world, and you're not going to find anything other than unhappiness and grief if that's all you have. You got to find that upper self, the upper plane, what Jesus has to give you. And that's my story.
The thieves who jumped their victims, the thieves that beat their victims, the thieves that stripped their victims, and the thieves that leave their victims half dead. All over this nation, every media outlet, you keep hearing on the names of criminals. You hear all these young men and women that are behind a prison cell. I want to remind you, the churches in America have sons and daughters that are in jail right now. They have sons and daughters that are in prison right now. We're so quick to underscore the people on the honor roll, but where have we left the people that are not on the honor roll? You know, those people might have lost their way, but we can't afford to give up on them. We can't leave them. Everybody who hears the sound of my voice today has a son, a daughter, a niece, somebody who's flunking out of school, who's hanging with the wrong crowd, someone who's got lost and is in a different direction and has no idea what they're supposed to do. But I came to remind you, these sons and these daughters are our sons and our daughters. I know you don't like it, but these are our sons and our daughters who are in jail. These are children that are in the Bloods and the Crips. These are our sons and daughters who are selling drugs to elementary students. And these are our sons who are raping our grandmothers and our daughters, unfortunately. And these are our sons and daughters in jail.
Yeah.
Who are robbing everybody. And everybody's left them. These are our sons and daughters that are confused about their sexual identity, about being homosexual. These are our daughters who are running pyramid schemes. If you dismiss them, you're going to lose the whole community. Ladies and gentlemen, even if the whole world washes their hands of the so-called bad son, the church has a responsibility to go in the community and take those sons and daughters back. You don't know how bad it is until you're there yourself. But everybody in this room has had a moment where people wanted to give up on you. People wanted to throw the towel on you, wash their hands of you. But you know, you were saved because you serve a God who saw something greater in you. Something greater than the mistakes you made. Something greater than the downfall that you had in your life. Somebody ought to give just praise God, because how many of you have stepped back and fallen down? How many of you had somebody forget about you? By all rights, we all shouldn't even be here. We should be dead. How many of us right here have drinking and drove? Drove a car while we were drinking. Shouldn't we kill somebody or maybe ourselves? How many of us have taken drugs and should be dead? How many of us have done things that we haven't gotten caught for? If you think about it, every one of us should be serving time right now. Every one of us should be in jail. But God has a greater thing for us. And I have to add one note. God didn't miss what you thought you didn't get caught for. Amen. God saw it. Don't think you slipped in there just because you turned the lights down low and whispered. God was in the room watching you with a flashlight, writing down everything you said, everything you thought, and everything you did. But our Savior can save us from it. You know, I just want to bring back here is, you know, young people, we ask ourselves, why are they in trouble? How can we consider why all these young people haven't met their fathers? Has anyone taken the time to figure out why half of them have dropped out of high school? Has anyone taken out the time to figure out none of them have a big brother or a big sister? I ask you, when you see someone in your family, somebody you know that's fallen down, when have you taken them under your arm? You've been where they've been. When they said, I don't have some money, I gotta rob somebody, you've been there. Heck, some of us are here right now with no money. But we gotta take them back. Can you figure out or find out why no church has claimed them as their membership? And it's God saying, I'd rather you be hot or cold, but you're lukewarm and you're making me sick to my stomach. You have your youth days, you have your men's programs and your day programs, but when are you going to get serious and roll up your sleeves and say, these are my sons, these are my daughters, and I'm going to bring them back to the church. I'm going to bring them back where they're supposed to be. I'm going to bring them back home. When's the next time someone in a church is going to do that? We have to show them there's another way, there's another opportunity. We're all sitting here, we're not in jail. We may have been in jail. We may have had problems, but there's someone that needs our guidance. And most importantly, God, we need to show them the way of God. Do you know why our prisons are overfilled? That's because we don't have leaders. We're getting ready to help somebody right here. Let me explain this something. If a Jewish boy gets arrested, he goes to jail. 12 men from the community go to the judge's house and they say, give that boy back to us. We don't want him sitting in jail. But they also tell the judge, if you see him one more time, he's out of the family. You know, I'm sick and tired of seeing all the Islamic faith having the strong men. Where are the strong men in the church today? Where are they? You know, we got to set up a standard. We got to go up there and say, you may not be our biological son, but you are my son. You need to grab him by the shirt and say, don't back talk me. I've been where you've been. I've done what you've done. And you don't have to go that way. We need to take him back. We need to have prayer vigils outside the prisons and the jails, praying for the sons and daughters that are in there. They're praying that they'll find a different way. They'll find to have a different opportunity. We got to start praying for them. Who's going to save them? Who's going to touch the ones that are in the jails right now? Look at the Osceola County Jail. I was a nurse there for 6 months. I'm not going to say, but there's somebody in here that was there that I met. He called me up and said he wanted Jesus in his life. But God was already in his life. But we're only going to pay for the rest of them. We can't dismiss them. They are our sons and our daughters, our leaders. Those are the people that are going to marry your sons and daughters. Those are the ones that are going to lead us forward. We can't leave them behind. Some of us are traitors. Well, you know, some of us have brothers and sisters in jail that we haven't visited. Some of us have nieces and uncles that are in there that no one's even called. Some of us have friends between a rock and a hard place, and all we can do is quote scripture to them. Well, why don't you shut the Bible and live the word? You know, God likes to say, I'd rather see someone live a sermon rather than read your sermon. I'd rather see a sermon, not hear a sermon. My message to you today, as I'm closing right now, we need to remember our sons and daughters. That's the purpose of this church right now. We're going to go back into community and claim membership to every single one there. No one is going to be left behind.
Amen.
I'm going to grab them. I'm going to hold them. Do you know? I'm going to tell you something right now. I was in the jail. Do you know when you get ready to go to court, there's a cage. They're put in an actual cage. It looks like a big bird cage. And you sit in this little thing, and all the correctionals or COs walk by. You want to know? Nobody says, I pray for you, I hope you do okay. No one says, man, I know you messed up, but you know God's there for you. You know what they really say? Be quiet, don't make any noise, and we might let you go. Sometimes they don't even get breakfast, and they don't get anything. They're sitting in that cage. But God is powerful. If you don't forget them, let me give a quick testimony. I was in the jail. I was in what we call Charlie. This is discipline player. This is where the people that get in trouble go there. This is where they stay. And you talk about noisy. I wonder how people think. You hear my own self think it's that noisy, that loud. No one cares about it. I went in there. And a man came up to me. I was in the second tier. And he said, he used to call me Preacher Man. And I said, Preacher Man, I didn't know, but Jesus was in my cell for the past 2 weeks. I just saw him. Do you want to know something? The whole block got quiet. The whole block. The drug dealers, the gangbangers, people that cursed, the spirit went in there and stopped that whole place. For 2 weeks, when you walked in, you witnessed people reading the Bible, translating from Spanish to English. Even the CO, when I walked out, it was a girl at that point, she goes up to me and says, you know, I have a good life, but my faith isn't strong enough. Pray for me. For 2 straight weeks, the Holy Spirit took over a block, not a cell. After 2 weeks, I guess couldn't handle it anymore. I had to leave. But you know what? It shows how strong God is on the block. If God can take over a block, the worst block in Moscow County Jail, can He not take over your life? Yeah. He cannot. You don't have to be a Christian. You can be set free. And there are people in that jail that are set free right now. I saw one. I was walking down from medical because I'm a nurse. And you know what? This man said hello, and I saw the Spirit God. You know when you see somebody, you know that they just got something about him? This man had the Spirit of God in him. He had nothing to worry about. I don't know what he was facing, but God was with him. And I'll tell you the truth, I pray that God will be with me like it is with him. He had no worries. He was all smiles. And I actually felt comfortable standing next to him. Imagine that. You feel comfortable standing next to an inmate that's in chains. But you'd rather be next to him than a security guard with a gun that tells you God is in that house. Praise be to God.